And welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why, and how of newspaper reading from your UPSC perspective. Now, as you all know, that DNS quizzes are now uploaded on our eLearn platform. So when you open the eLearn Rao IS webpage, you can directly see the DNS of the day. For example, yesterday's DNS was uploaded on the platform. And to find the quiz, you can go into the See Detail page, whereby a new page opens and you can see all the different topics which have been discussed. And if you want to listen any particular topic, just you can click this particular picture and that topic starts from that particular point. Now as you scroll down, you'll find the prelims quiz or the DNS quiz for the day. So what you can do is to take this quiz. Suppose I answer A to this particular question. However, the answer is D. And here you also find solution or an explanation to your answer. So this is what we have provided with respect to DNS quiz on the eLearn platform. Further, you can also download notes with respect to your PDF format. And a word page will open with respect to the PDF format of that particular day. As you can see, these were the different news which were discussed yesterday. Now, apart from your daily DNS quiz, we have also uploaded subject-wise DNS quiz. So to go to the subject-wise DNS quiz, what you can do is to go to the prelims test and then click on the test series. As you can see, there are DNS quiz or MCQs from the Hindu newspaper. So to go to this subject-wise DNS quiz, just click on this MCQs from the Hindu newspaper of DNS quizzes. And you can see the different DNS quizzes of different subjects which have been uploaded. For example, DNS quiz on Indian economy has been uploaded, on science and technology has been uploaded, international relations, Indian polity and constitution, as well as environment, ecology and biodiversity has been uploaded on the website. Now the subject-wise DNS quiz includes questions from May 2019 to March 2020, which we have discussed in our DNS videos. Now you can take these quizzes on different subjects as it will help you not only to evaluate your understandings and learnings, but also to revise your current affairs topics in different subjects which has appeared in the Hindu newspaper accordingly in different months. Now apart from the DNS quiz, we have also added revision MCQs on different subjects. As of now, the revision MCQs on science and technology as well as on Indian economy has been uploaded. And you can find these revision DNS MCQs when you click on the study material option. So when we click on the study material option, we see science and technology MCQs from DNS. And these questions cover from a time period of May 2019 to March 2020. So basically whatever topics we have discussed or whatever questions which we framed on those different important topics, these questions can be found in this particular PDF of DNS revision MCQs on science and technology. Now apart from these DNS quizzes, we have also uploaded Focus magazine as well as Compass magazine for your prelims examination 2020 for different subjects. As you can see, the prelims 2020 Compass has been uploaded on the subject of budget and economic survey, on environment, ecology and biodiversity, on government schemes, on Indian polity and governance, as well as on the Indian economy. So you can explore yourself this website, that is elearn.raois.com, and find important study materials which are important for your examination perspective. Now with this, let's move on to our daily news discussion for the articles displayed on the screen for the Hindu newspaper dated 12th April 2020. Now the first news to be discussed appears on page number 12 in the FAQ section. It says COVID-19 and immunity. Who are most vulnerable and why are men, women and children reacting differently? Now this article or this FAQ explains about how our immune system reacts, especially when it is invaded by any foreign body, including coronavirus. So this article highlights about our predictable responses with respect to our immune system, especially fighting the COVID-19 virus. Because our immune system and its fight back against coronavirus will determine the number of people dying because of the coronavirus. Now first and foremost, we should know that coronavirus are a group of enveloped positive stranded RNA viruses that consist of four structural proteins. These four structural proteins are: number 1, spike glycoprotein, that is S protein, envelope protein, that is E protein, membrane protein, that is M protein, and nucleocapsid protein, that is N protein. Now, of these four proteins, it is the S protein, that is spike protein, which binds with the receptor on the epithelial cells on the lower respiratory tract. Basically, it is the spike protein which causes the most damage as it binds with the surface cells in the lower respiratory tract. Now, as we know, for the virus, the entry points are eyes, nose, as well as mouth. Hence, it is said to cover our face with the mask and also to use hand gloves if possible while going out. So once we breathe the virus inside our body, it reaches the lower respiratory tract comprising of trachea, primary bronchi, as well as lungs. Basically, these aspects which are responsible for our breathing functions. Now what happens is that the spike proteins, once they have entered the body and have reached the lower respiratory tract, then they bind or get attached on the surface of the lungs and they form a crown-like appearance or a crown-like shape. So, once they are settled on the surface of the lungs, they get attached to respiratory tract as well as to the air sacs in the lungs. And the coronavirus does this by locking itself into the epithelial cells or the surface cells of the lower respiratory tract. Basically, by locking itself with the surface cells of respiratory tract as well as air sacs in the lungs, and it is here where the problem arises. So effectively, these spike proteins of the coronavirus binds with the ACE2 receptor of the epithelial cells of the lungs, and it basically hijacks our immune system by multiplying. That is, the virus multiplies and covers the entire lower respiratory tract or the entire lungs, and this also causes problems in our breathing. So once all this happens, our immune system fights back, and this is done, that is, the fighting of the immune system is done by producing antibodies and also by activating cytokines and chemokines. Now basically, these cytokines and chemokines are produced as a reaction to expel any foreign body in our system. So it says that cytokines are signaling molecules, and these are produced by cells for specific biological functions, mainly to expel any foreign body. And it says, for example, interleukin is a type of cytokine produced by white cells as signaling molecules, whereas chemokine is a type of cytokine which is produced as a chemoattractant molecules to attract cells to sites of infection or inflammation. So basically, these cytokines and chemokines are produced as a reaction by the immune system to expel these foreign bodies which have entered into our system. So once these cytokines and chemokines are activated, it alerts the immune system to destroy the foreign body or expel the foreign body, namely the virus which has entered into our system. Now, activation of cytokines and chemokines triggers inflammation in the cells, and this inflammation produces mucus as well as running nose. And this is done basically to trap these viral particles or these viruses, thereby restricting their entry into our system. And this mechanism overall triggers sneezes, as it helps to expel these foreign viruses or foreign body from our system completely. So activation of cytokines and chemokines also results in inflammation of sinus, which we normally refer as cold, and it also results in inflammation of hypothalamus, which results in fever. So this is basically how the immune system fights back. Now the case with coronavirus is slightly different as compared to the normal reaction of our immune system. Now these coronavirus, with the help of spike proteins, penetrate deeper into lungs and damage the epithelial cells, and this triggers inflammation of lungs, and this results in fluid build up because of the virus. So because of the coronavirus, fluid is built up in our lungs. So once fluid is built up in the lungs, the immune system wants to expel this fluid built up in the lungs outside the body, and this results in dry cough, and this dry cough is a symptom of coronavirus infection. Further, more infection by coronavirus in the lungs or the cells of the lungs results in difficulty in breathing, as lungs finds it harder to extract oxygen from the air, which is its core or basic function. And this overall results in breathlessness of the system. And a person suffering with extreme case of coronavirus has to be put on ventilator. Now, this article further mentions about the ability of different age group of human beings to cope with the coronavirus, whereby the article mentions about children, adults, as well as elderly. And ultimately, it boils down to our immune system. Now, elderly people already suffers from different other ailments such as cardiovascular diseases or any other type of diseases. And it is often found that immune system in elderly people are comparatively lower as compared to adults. However, with respect to children, this article highlights that it is still unknown why children are able to cope more better with respect to COVID-19 virus as compared to elderly or even adults. Now, infection by coronavirus also depends on degree of infection in the lungs, as the lungs get inflated because of buildup of cytokines in the lungs. And this buildup of cytokines in the lungs is referred as acute respiratory distress syndrome. It says that acute respiratory distress syndrome occurs when fluid builds up in the tiny elastic air sacs or alveoli in our lungs. And presence of these fluids in the alveoli prevents enough oxygen or enough air to enter into the lungs. And this means less oxygen reaches our bloodstream. And this effectively deprives our organs of the oxygen which they need. So basically, there are two aspects involved here. Because of coronavirus, it not only leads to acute respiratory distress syndrome by buildup of more cytokine in the lungs, that is buildup of more fluids in the lungs, thereby depleting the lungs of oxygen. And it also results in less oxygen being supplied through the blood streams. Further, it also depletes the white blood cells in our body, and the reduction or depletion of white blood cells in the body makes our entire immune system vulnerable to other infections. And depletion of white blood cells as well as buildup of cytokines in our lungs also damages other organs, especially of the elderly people, namely kidney as well as heart. And failure of other organs apart from lungs also results in death, mostly of the elderly people, as they already suffer from cardiovascular diseases. Now, this article also suggests that men are more likely to fall ill because of coronavirus as compared to women. And this is because of the presence of estrogen in women. As estrogen is not only an immune system modulator for women, and it also helps women in pregnancy. So this topic becomes important from the perspective of general science in your prelims examination, and in your mains gets covered under GS paper 3, specifically with respect to science and technology. Now, questions can be expected on various aspects of COVID-19, specifically from the perspective of general science. Hence, this topic becomes important from your prelims point of view. With this, let's move on to our next news discussion. Now, the next news appears on page number 10. It says, holdings in gold-backed exchange-traded funds at an all-time high in March. A record-breaking quarter as holdings assets added $23 billion in net flows as per the World Gold Council. Now, this news highlights about gold exchange-traded funds. So, in this regard, you must know about exchange-traded funds as well as gold-based exchange-traded funds. Now, what has happened so far, because of the COVID-19 fears, the market has witnessed selling of shares. However, during these uncertain times, investors generally look for security as well as safety for their investment. And in this regard, they find that gold is their best regard. So it is in this regard, it has been observed by the World Gold Council that gold-backed exchange-traded funds has assumed huge significance and has attracted $23 billion in the first quarter of 2020 itself. So in this aspect, you must know about gold-backed exchange-traded funds, as questions can be asked in your upcoming prelims examination. Now, exchange-traded funds are such funds which invest in shares, bonds, as well as commodities, and their prices are dependent as per the market value or market share. Further, these value of ETF or exchange-traded funds depends on their underlying security, and these are also traded on stock exchange. So these are some of the basic aspects with respect to exchange traded funds. So on similar lines, gold based exchange traded funds are such exchange traded funds which invest in gold, and a company which issues these gold-based exchange-traded funds invest such money in physical gold and convert such investment in different units of paper-based ETF. Now let us understand this aspect. So point to be understood is that investment in physical gold by any company gets converted into ETF units. So suppose, for example, a mutual fund company has invested worth 5 kg of gold for ETF. Now these investments in physical gold will get converted into ETF units based on the value of gold. Now 1 gram of gold is equal to 1 unit of ETF. So here 5 kg of gold will be equivalent to 5,000 units of ETF. And this is how gold-backed exchange-traded funds are invested in the stock market. So it says that normally 1 unit of gold ETF in paper form represents 1 gram of physical gold. So when a person buys 10 units of ETF, this is equivalent to buying 10 grams of gold. Now it's important to note that a person buying these units of gold-backed ETFs does not get the physical gold or does not get the custody of physical gold. He only gets the units of these ETFs which represents physical gold in the stock market or in the financial market. And these gold-backed exchange-traded funds can be purchased or sold in the stock exchange as well. So these are some of the fundamental points with respect to gold-based or gold-backed exchange-traded funds, as these can be traded in the stock market and it is traded as per ETF units, where generally 1 gram of gold is equivalent to 1 unit of ETF. So the question is that, is on selling these ETF units, does a person actually get physical gold? Now in this you must note that there are only very few institutions which provide the option to redeem gold-based ETFs, that is gold-based exchange-traded funds, in terms of physical gold. And mostly this redemption for physical gold is done for large investment in golds. So it highlights that for large investors, redemption in terms of physical gold is allowed only after their investment exceeds a certain threshold or a certain value. And this threshold varies across ETF and is usually above 1 kg of gold, which is equivalent to 1,000 units of gold-based ETF. So in this regard, we can say there are definitely certain advantages with respect to buying gold-based ETF. First, it is a very secure investment, as there is no concerns with respect to theft or even storing the physical gold. Second, it is easily transactable, as it can be traded on stock exchanges. Third, it can be used as a collateral for borrowing money or to take loans. So it acts as a loan collateral. And fourth, it gives a higher returns as compared to other investments because of safety and security of gold itself. So an investment in gold-based ETF definitely gives a higher returns to the investors. So these can be said to be some of the advantages of gold-based ETF or a gold-based exchange-traded fund. Now this news also highlights about World Gold Council. And in this regard, its website highlights that World Gold Council is the market development organization for the gold industry, and its purpose is to stimulate and sustain demand for gold, provide industry leadership, and also be the global authority on gold market. Further, the World Gold Council also develops policies and also set industry standards with respect to gold mining. It says that this council works with different governments, international agencies, and policymakers to develop policies that reduce barriers and improve access to gold. The World Gold Council develops globally recognized standards which create clarity and consistency where it is lacking and reinforce trust across the gold value chain, as it enhances the gold industry's acceptance as a mainstream asset and also broaden its investors' appeal. So these can be said to be some of the important aspects with respect to World Gold Council. Now it's also important to know that the World Gold Council has developed the conflict-free gold standard, and it helps companies to provide assurance that the gold is not contributing to any conflict. Now, this is because there have been growing concerns that these newly mined gold can be used to finance armed conflicts and rebellions in different countries. So, in this regard, there was a need to ensure that the gold which is mined is sold in the market does not indirectly finance such conflicts. So, in this regard, the conflict-free gold standard provides assurance that the gold has been extracted in a manner which does not cause, support, or benefit unlawful armed conflict or contribute to serious human rights abuses or breaches of international humanitarian law. So, in this regard, you must know about conflict-free gold standard policy, which has been developed by the World Gold Council. And this also becomes an important aspect to be remembered from your prelims perspective. So, this news on gold-based exchange-traded funds becomes important from your prelims point of view. And this topic gets covered under Indian economy in your prelims examination, and in your mains gets covered under GS paper 3. With this, let's move on to our next news discussion. The next news appears on page number 6. It says, states must evolve norms to help laborers return. Gadkari. Minister discusses economic revival once lockdown ends. Now, in this news, the Union Minister for Micro, Medium and Small Scale Enterprises has highlighted that the flight of migrant labor from cities is a serious issue. However, it is up to the state to form guidelines or frame guidelines for their return to their respective native places. Further, the minister has also highlighted about the MSME sector, where it says that it employs nearly 11 crore people and is labor intensive. So, in this regard, you must know about the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Act of 2006, as this act provides for existing classification based on investment in plant machinery as well as on equipments. And the 2006 act differentiates the MSME sector with respect to manufacturing industries and services sector. So, it highlights that micro industries are such industries where investment is less than rupees 25 lakhs. Whereas for services, micro industries are such industries where investment is less than 10 lakh rupees. Further, with respect to small industries, it highlights that the investment is more than 25 lakhs and less than rupees 5 crores. Whereas for services, it is more than rupees 10 lakhs and less than rupees 2 crores. Further, for medium enterprises or medium industries, it is more than 5 crores of investment and less than 10 crores of investment for the manufacturing sector. And for services, it is more than 2 crores and less than 5 crores of investment. So, this classification is based as per the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Act of 2006. Now, in this regard, you should also know about UK Sinha Committee, as the committee has suggested to reform the entire MSME sector as well as the laws, including the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Act of 2006, in order to improve ease of doing business in the MSME sector. Now, accordingly, the government moved the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Amendment Bill 2018. However, the bill has so far not been ratified by both houses of the parliament. It has classified MSME sector as per annual turnover, where for micro enterprises, it is less than rupees 5 crore, where for small enterprises, it is more than 5 crores and less than 75 crores, and for medium enterprises, it is more than 75 crores and less than 250 crores. So, this is the proposed classification, and it has also been proposed under the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Amendment Bill of 2018. So, in this regard, you should know this classification and also about this amendment from your prelims perspective in your Indian economy section. Thus, in this news analysis, you should know about this act, which provides for the classification of manufacturing and services with respect to MSME sector, and also about UK Sinha Committee, as it has proposed to reform the MSME sector and also its laws in order to improve ease of doing business of the MSME sector. Now, the next news to be discussed also appears in the FAQ section on page number 12. It says, to ease lockdown, what are the options? What are the health measures that must be in place before lifting the shutdown across states? Now, this article highlights that it has been more than 2 weeks for the national lockdown. And as per the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, without the national lockdown, the cases in COVID-19 virus in India could have easily exceeded 8 lakh. And then it would have become extremely difficult to manage these 8 lakh cases. So the thing is, at some point or the other, this national lockdown will end. However, the question is that how will the government end this national lockdown which was imposed for a period of 21 days? Now, as per the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare of the Indian government, as of now, that is on 12th April 2020, active cases of coronavirus is around 7,367. People who have been discharged or cured are 715, and 273 deaths have occurred due to coronavirus. So the question before the government is as to how to open the national lockdown so that normal life can be restored again. So in this regard, this article highlights that there are certain necessary measures which must be undertaken by the government before ending the national lockdown completely. Further, another problem is that there is no past experience or any precedent with respect to handling or tackling these pandemic cases of COVID-19 or the crisis which has been created because of the pandemic of COVID-19. So as of now, there is no guide for the future course of actions for the government. So the government has to rely on the recommendations provided by various health experts with respect to COVID-19 situation. So the government might come up with the concept of staggered exit or stepwise exit. So in this regard, a stage-wise exit or a staggered exit, as has also been recommended by the Prime Minister of India, seems a possible solution towards our future. Now, with respect to exit from this national lockdown or to end the national lockdown, two things are of primary importance. First is the safety of people, and second is the preparedness of the state or the government to tackle any further cases of COVID-19. So these two aspects of safety and preparedness must be ensured by the government so that national lockdown can be removed in a staggered way or in a stage-wise process. So in this regard, this article mentions about certain essential checklists before removing the national lockdown by the governments. These checklists include: have the cases started to decline in any particular area? Are all hot spots contained where maximum cases of COVID-19 was registered? Next, do we have the capability for rapid identification, isolation, as well as testing in any state, region, district, etc.? And fourth and lastly, are people aware enough to continue to be careful in times to come? Now here the role and responsibility of citizens or the people becomes important, because now COVID-19 situation has become a reality and people have to live with this particular situation till the time we have become immune to this virus. So it is in these aspects this article provides for a stepwise or a staggered exit solution for the government of India, whereby the article has mentioned about four stages of exit with respect to ending the national lockdown completely. So let's go through these four stages of exit as has been suggested by the author in this particular FAQ. So the first phase towards ending this lockdown is to know whether cases in a particular area, district or community has started to decline drastically. So this can be said to be the first phase of removing the national lockdown. So once phase 1 has been achieved, then we can move to phase 2 by reopening different states, however with restrictions on public gathering. So in the stage 2, still there would be restrictions on public gathering. And stage 2 or phase 2 will also depend on severity of case and level of preparedness. And in case there is an increase in cases of COVID-19 virus, then the state or the area again has to go back to phase 1 of the lockdown. Now in phase 2, we can take such states where very less number of COVID-19 cases were reported. So for example, we can take the entire Northeast India, as the 7 Northeast states could be reopened in the first go as there were very less cases in the entire Northeastern states. Further, with respect to phase 2, this article says that each state or individual states can move to this phase when they are able to safely diagnose, treat and isolate COVID-19 cases and their contacts. So there are two aspects with respect to phase 2. One is restriction on public gathering still exists, whereas day-to-day activities continue, and the state is capable enough to safely diagnose, treat and isolate COVID-19 cases. Now from phase 2, we come to phase 3, where this phase shall begin when major portion of society has immune protection from COVID-19 virus. Now the author highlights about phase 4, which is equivalent to the situation which was prior to the COVID-19 crisis. Now in this, the author suggests that the final exit, which is exactly before the COVID-19 time, should come with readiness for the next pandemic, as a second and a more dangerous wave of coronavirus may attack humans in times to come. So the government of India as well as of the world must be ready to tackle the next pandemic, which will be much larger as compared to the present COVID-19 situation. So these are the four phases of opening of lockdown as has been suggested in this article or in this FAQ. So it is in this regard that government of India as well as different states must be capable enough with respect to augmenting its health infrastructure to diagnose, treat as well as isolate any cases of COVID-19. And only once we are able to achieve this particular situation with respect to health emergency, then can the complete national lockdown be removed. However, let's wait for the announcement of the Prime Minister of India with respect to ending of national lockdown or with respect to its further extension. Now this topic with respect to alternate options of ending a lockdown gets covered under GS Paper 3 as well as GS Paper 2 in your mains examination. In GS Paper 3, it gets covered under disaster and disaster management, and in GS Paper 2, it gets covered under welfare schemes for vulnerable sections and issues relating to health. Now questions can be expected in your mains examination with respect to this particular article with respect to staggered exit from the national lockdown imposed because of the COVID-19 situation. Now the next two news appears on page number 7 in the magazine section of the Hindu newspaper. The first news is with respect to return of the native, and this news is about leatherback turtle. Now in this regard, you should know about leatherback turtle. First of all, that it has been declared as vulnerable as per the IUCN Red List. Next, it has been categorized under Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 under the amphibians and reptiles. Now any wildlife species, if it is put under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, then there is a prohibition of hunting of such animals. It says that no person shall hunt any wild animals specified in Schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4 except as provided under Section 11 and 12. And these exceptions are basically with respect to research purposes as well as for the conservation of these wildlife species. So it is in this aspect you should know about leatherback turtle, as it has been declared as vulnerable and it is also part of Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act. Further, it is also protected under CITES, as international trade on leatherback turtle is prohibited. So this topic becomes important from your prelims perspective under the subject of environment. Now the next news also appears on page number 7 in the magazine section with respect to quiz. Now in this section, there are certain very important facts which you should know from your examination perspective. So let us go through some of the important facts which have been highlighted in this quiz section of the magazine of Hindu newspaper. Now it says that this gentleman was appointed as first national professor by the new government of independent India. He went on to become the first non-Caucasian individual to win a Nobel Prize in science. A keen lover of music, he also investigated the harmonic nature of the sound of tabla and mridangam. He started a company which manufactured potassium chlorate for the match industry. Who was he and who had such fascination with light? In this, the correct answer is Sir C.V. Raman. So in this, you must know about various aspects with respect to Sir C.V. Raman, the fact that he has won a Nobel Prize, and you should also know about mridangam. The next important aspect highlighted is with respect to point 4. It says he was born in present-day Patna in 475 CE, and this person is regarded as the first mathematician astronomer from ancient India. His major work covers arithmetic, algebra, plane trigonometry and spherical trigonometry. It also contains continued fractions, quadratic equations, sums of power series and a table of signs. In it, he talks about how phi is irrational, a theory which was only proved in Europe in 1761. The Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics in Pune has a statue of him in its courtyard. Who is this pioneer physicist? And this, the correct answer is Aryabhatta. Now, next aspect is with respect to Henry Dunant. It highlights that he was a Swiss businessman who was on a business trip in 1859 to Italy. There, he witnessed the aftermath of Battle of Solferino. This inspired him to create the International Committee of the Red Cross to care for wounded soldiers. And this led to him and Frederic Passy, a French pacifist, to become the first people to win certain award in 1901. So what award did they win? In this, the correct answer is Nobel Peace Prize. As questions have been asked on Red Cross Society by UPSC, so in this regard, this information becomes important. Now the next highlight is with respect to Joshi Crater. It says that the Joshi Crater is named after Anandibai Joshi, who was the first Indian origin woman to earn a medical degree in the United States. Further, the Zehrat Crater is named after Jerusha Zehrat, who was the first woman to be awarded a Government of India scholarship to study in the United Kingdom. And her efforts to improve medical education, especially for women in India, earned her the Member of the British Empire title in the United Kingdom and Padma Shri in India. These women were trailblazers and are honored with these craters named after them. Where in the universe are these craters located? So here the correct answer is surface of Venus. The ninth point highlights that on April 12, 1907, a new flag was created on the order of King James VI of Scotland. He had inherited the English and Irish thrones, thereby uniting the crowns of England, Scotland and Ireland. What is the name of this flag, which we would see in many other flags as well? Here the correct answer is Union Jack. And this topic becomes important primarily from the perspective of world history. And lastly, it mentions about Armal Collite, which is a titanium-rich mineral. It was first discovered in 1969 and named after three men who were closest to it at the time. The synthesis of Armal Collite requires low pressures, high temperatures and rapid quenching from about 1000 degrees Celsius to the ambient temperature. So who are these three people it is named after? These are Armstrong, Aldrin and Collins, who were the first men to step on Moon. So this quiz highlights some of the important aspects which can be asked by UPSC in the prelims examination. Hence, this quiz also becomes important. Now, after today's discussion, this forms your summary for your prelims examination. You should know about coronavirus, the different proteins with respect to coronavirus such as spike protein, envelope protein, membrane protein and nucleocapsid protein. And also the fact that spike protein binds with ACE2 receptor of the epithelial cells of lower respiratory tracts or the lungs. Then you should know about cytokines and chemokines as they are activated to expel foreign body entering in our system. You should know about inflammation of lungs with respect to coronavirus and acute respiratory distress syndrome, as it leads to accumulation of cytokines in the lungs. Then you should know about gold-based exchange-traded funds, the fact that they are traded in the stock market and they are traded in units, where 1 gram of gold is equivalent to 1 unit. And you should also know with respect to redemption of gold and advantages of gold-based exchange-traded funds. Then you should know about World Gold Council, as it develops organization of gold industry, sets standards for the industry, and also you should know about conflict-free gold standard, as this conflict-free gold standard is provided by the World Gold Council. Then you should know about the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Act of 2006, the classification of MSMEs as provided in Section 7 of this particular act, and also about UK Sinha Committee, as it has suggested wide-scale reforms with respect to MSME sector. Then you must know about leatherback turtle, its IUCN status, which is vulnerable, and also the fact that it has been provided under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act, and it is also protected under CITES. Further, with respect to the quiz section, you should know about C.V. Raman, Aryabhatta, International Committee of Red Cross, as it has also won a Nobel Prize. About Venus, as it contains Joshi Crater and Zehrat Crater. Further, you should also know about Armal Collite, as it is a titanium-rich mineral, and also about Union Jack, as it was created under the orders of King James VI of Scotland. Now, after our discussion, let us go through the question for the day. So, the question for the day is, consider the following statements about leatherback turtle. Options are, 1. It has been categorized as vulnerable as per IUCN Red List. 2. It has been provided under Schedule 2 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And Statement 3, it has been mentioned under CITES. So the question is, which of the statements given above are correct? Options are A, 1 and 2 only, B, 2 and 3 only, C, 1 and 3 only, and D, none of the above. Now coming to the answer of yesterday, the question was, in the context of global oil prices, Brent crude oil is frequently referred to in the news. What does this term imply? This question was asked by UPSC in the prelims of 2011. Options were, first, it is a major classification of crude oil. Second, it is sourced from North Sea. And third, it does not contain sulfur. In this, the third statement was incorrect. So in this, the correct answer was B, that is 1 and 2 only.